Women participation in governance issues and challenges. This is another important essay as a part of the woman empowerment. It is much understood perception that women are not aware of any governance aspect since they are mainly and actively involved in household and community work. On the contrary, their day-to-day working experience enables them well aware of real issues faced by the common people. This gives them insight and perspective which can be instrumental in sustainable overall development of the society and nation at large. Therefore, the presence of women in local government should serve as an encouragement for other women to enter diverse professions. It will also lead to breaking the stereotypes of women's roles in society and public space. Present-day women civil servants have proved again and again their competency in various governance aspects. In fact, enormous success of women candidates in the civil service examinations and other competitive examinations is enough proof of their ability to understand and also assimilate complex administrative issues. Therefore, people have gained confidence in women as a good public administrators and local government representatives after seeing women making positive difference in other people's life. Therefore, the society acknowledges the sincerity and commitment of women to their duties. In fact, the general perception of the public is that women offer resistance to corruption and criminalization in day-to-day life. Successive governments in India have understood the need to actively involve women in all levels of governance, especially at the local levels. Therefore, women participation at the local level is an evolving area and many efforts are being done in this direction. Now let us see the women political participation in Indian politics in a historical context. The status of women in India has had a checkered history. It was in fact par status with men in the ancient history and later on being veils, that is in Parda system during the medieval period. In the post-independent India, the status of women regained its strength and in fact it has been on a rise ever since. Women in post-independent India have been participating in almost all types of economic activities, day-to-day households, chores and voting for a better governance and also in active politics. India has elected a woman Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi, and also woman President, Pratibha Patil, which are the highest posts in the Indian polity. In the present central government, women comprise nearly a quarter of Indian cabinet with portfolios like external affairs, commerce and human resource development. At the ground level, India also has a significant proportion of women at all local level politics. It has been made possible because of reserving seat for women in the gram panchayats. Now, it is very interesting to know that the women played a very significant role during the freedom movement. Now, women participated in the freedom movement with a true spirit and undaunted courage and faced tortures, exploitations and hardships to earn us freedom. Many great Indian women like Rani Lakshmibai, Sarojini Naidu, Kasturba Gandhi, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, Annie Besant proved their dedication and undying devotion to the service of India. Indian women who joined the national movement were initially from educated and liberal families. But this position changed with the advent of Mahatma Gandhi, who converted the freedom struggle into a mass movement and it involved all sections of society. His most successful campaign against the imperial rule was fought on the issue of salt tax, which brought Indian women to the forefront. Local issues started getting debated and women took center stage in this regard. At this stage, it is important to discuss the Women Reservation Bill. Post-Gandhi era, India experienced a centralization of planning, but this resulted in a higher inequality in political decision-making at various levels. While government was deeply concerned of issues of gender equality, women were not always part of such decision making. India has seen examples of women participating in politics as a longest, such as the longest serving prime minister, chief ministers of various states, members in national parliament and legislative assemblies. But such examples are isolated and they are in fact elite oriented. It was because the woman came from elite and well connected family background. In order to enable better women participation in active politics, efforts were made by way of reservation for women. But this also has not been entirely successful in true terms because of the non-support of some of the regional parties in various states. Back in history, it is an irony to note one of the prominent members of the freedom struggle, Sarojini Naidu, rejected a reservation for women because her reasoning was very progressive. She argued women are not weak, timid and weak. Therefore, the issue of women reservation again came to limelight in 1973. And here the voices were there recommending reservation for women in at least one third of the states. However, this proposal or the move did not succeed at state and national legislative levels, and eventually statutory women's role in panchayats at the village level was introduced and successfully and it was implemented. This act was meant to bring women in the fore in rural development program, and it was done through 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment in 1993. However, Women's Reservation Bill or the Constitution, that is 108th Amendment Bill, is a pending bill in India even now. This bill proposes to reserve 33% of all seats in the lower house of parliament and in local level also in state legislative assemblies. Women Reservation Bill was passed way in Rajya Sabha way back in 2010, but Lok Sabha could not clear the bill because of the resistance of some regional parties on certain provisions of the bill. Women empowerment, therefore, in a local governance in India has, as it is working, has had a significant impact in village life at panchayat level. Now, therefore, it needs a special discussion here. Now, women and panchayat raj reforms. Indian Constitution made provisions relating to the establishment of powers and responsibilities of the panchayats through 73rd Amendment in 1993, as said earlier, and it had a three-tier system, that is panchayats, that is village governance bodies at the village, intermediate and district levels in every state, and of course the exception was provision of skipping intermediate level in states with less than 20 lakh population. In this, the states were empowered through a law for the composition of the panchayats. The reform provided for reservation of both seats and leadership positions for the scheduled caste, tribes and women. A normal duration of 5 years for panchayats also was provided. They were also given authority of preparing the electoral rolls and conducting elections in the state election commission. The state government is also empowered to make laws providing criteria for disqualification of candidature from panchayat elections and also to legislate with respect to maintenance of accounts by the panchayats and their audit. Thus, the Panchayat Raj reforms became institutions of the self-government. There was a devolution of powers and responsibilities upon panchayats. This fact has helped all the sections of the society, including women, to take part to share the responsibility of governance and development, at least at the sub-district levels. The number of women elected representatives at local level has sharply increased, and India has been maintaining a record number of women representatives at the panchayat level. The statistics indicate that as many as 30 to 50% of local elected representatives in India are women. It has to be noted that the constitutional provisions of India are in fact in favor of women. Indian constitution guarantees equal political rights, including the right to vote to women. Also, almost all the provisions contained in the United Nations Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women are there in our constitution. There is even scope for positive discrimination in our constitution, and it is in the favor of women, and it is evident in Article 15(3) of the constitution. There are many other provisions in the constitution which lay stress on equality between men and women. Let us see what are they. Number 1, there is Article 14 which provides for equality before law. Number 2, Article 39A states that the state shall direct its policy towards securing equally to men and women the right to an adequate means of livelihood. And number 3, Article 39B empowers the state to direct its policy towards securing equal pay for equal work for both men and women. Next, the Article 42 provides for securing just and human conditions of work and for maternity leave, and Article 51AE refers to the fundamental duty of citizens to renounce practices which are derogatory to the dignity of women. Now let us see the state of affairs as regards the representation of women in parliament and state legislatures in India. Even 6 decades after independence, the representation of women in the Lok Sabha do not present an impressive picture. This proportion has not crossed 10%. In the first Lok Sabha, there were only 22 women constituting only 4.4% of the house. It has increased marginally over the years, and the 14th Lok Sabha, the strength of the women members was only 51. Similarly, in the Raj Sabha in 1952, the number of women members was merely 15. It constituted 7% of the membership of the house. Over the years, the percentage of women has increased marginally, and now, out of 242 members in the Rajya Sabha, only 23 are women, and they constitute only 9.5%. Let us see the state of affairs in state legislatures. The woman representation in the state legislatures also has been equally dismal. At present, the average percentage of elected women in state assemblies is 7%. The highest is 14.4% in Haryana, and the lowest is 1.3% in Karnataka. States like Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland and Union Territory of Puducherry have no representation of women in their assemblies at all. Therefore, as said before, the very encouraging and positive side of women empowerment has been in the area of reservation for women in local bodies only. Now, what are the challenges in measuring women political participation and how it can be increased further? One of the main challenges in measuring women participation remains challenge to estimate the actual participation of women in decision-making process. And there is one important aspect of participation as a proxy candidate. There have been ample evidences that due to reservation policy, certain women got elected to the setup, but they acted merely as a mouthpiece of their male family members. This indicates that the women participation is higher notionally than what it actually exists and belong. Awareness programs and increase in female education is now taking care of such happenings, and women active participation is on the increase. Still, it has to be said that there is a need to record data at a more micro level so that women who only act as a proxy can be identified. Second important aspect is the measurement of decision-making initiatives. The qualitative data on the aspects of women active participation is missing in this area. Utilization of the decision-making functionality is provided to them, but it is not being quantified properly. The valuable essence of the woman into the system is yet to be established at most of the places. The data on their sensitization about their rights and its usage is still missing. Therefore, efforts can be made to capture the performance of women in debates, initiative in bringing legislation, and participation in other aspects of a democratic process. Now let us see what are the possible approaches for a robust measurement framework for women's participation and how it can be included to measure the women participation effectively. One is the application of technology. The new government in India has a penchant for using technology for taking government schemes to the remote areas and population. The digital communication advancement may be introduced to capture the actual participation of women in panchayat activities by counting their attendance and their vote sharing in passing decisions in the panchayats. Portals and mobile applications may be developed to voice the women issues by calling response from the general women across the country. The second method is application of analytics. There are advanced analytics that can be used, and they can be used to validate, cluster and segment data regarding women participation in local politics. Big data techniques have allowed policy planners to work with a huge chunk of data which can be both quantitative as well as qualitative. Techniques like text mining and video mining can be utilized to extract meaningful information out of the huge data. The third method would be the development of women political participation score. It involves a collection of data on women participation in politics, which is essential for policymakers. Data required for this task may include all three aspects of political participation, that is, women as electorate, women as elected representatives, and women as policy makers. Other aspects of gender statistics also can be included as an input to give a holistic measure of women participation in the area.